And the member withdrew the comment at the time, and I'm now inviting the Green member to continue. Holly Walker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm proud to stand in strong opposition to the Social Security Benefit Categories and Work Focus Amendment Bill. And I'd like to focus my comments in particular on the impact that this bill will have on children, because children is something that we're all talking about at the moment. And I think that if there's one thing that we all agree in the House, it is that we are failing our children currently when we allow one in four children growing up in New Zealand to live in conditions of deprivation and poverty. And Mr. Speaker, this bill makes the bold assertion in the explanatory note that it will improve outcomes for children by helping parents out of poverty. And if only, Mr. Speaker, if only that really was the focus of the welfare system or the focus of this bill. But in fact, this bill will do quite the opposite. And I want to address my comments to that today. So the way that this bill is supposed to help improve outcomes for children is through the rather sinister and Orwellian language, which I think is probably familiar to members who remember Jenny Shipley's Code of Social Responsibility, which I remember debating at high school, in terms of talking about social obligations. And I quote, using the welfare system to reinforce some important social norms relating to children's education and health through the use of obligations that beneficiaries with children must meet in order to continue receiving government assistance. Now, I find that language very concerning, Mr. Speaker, as I'm sure do many members of the House. Those obligations, as we've heard, are things like ensuring that children are enrolled in 15 hours of early childhood education from the age of three, enrolled at a PHO to receive healthcare, meeting their well child checks, and being enrolled at school when they are of age to do that. Those are all good things for children to do, Mr. Speaker, but there's an inherent tension and a lack of logic in the government's approach to these issues in this bill, and it goes like this. We have a problem of child poverty, and we know that children are missing out on the basics and are not having access to the services that they need to get the best start in life. We want to do something about this, and the government says what we're going to do about this is provide parents with less income with which to provide those basic services. The logic goes in circles. Parents don't have enough income to provide the basics, so we'll punish them for not providing the basics by cutting their income. And it's absurd. It's absolutely absurd logic, Mr. Speaker, and it completely undermines the bill's supposed objective to improve outcomes for children, because all it will do is place children and their families in greater hardship. And the government knows that it will place children and their families in greater hardship, because they actually budget for it to do that in their costings and the way that they anticipate the bill will apply. So never mind the fact that families already make trade-offs like doctors' bills versus power bills and fuel versus food in stretched financial environments, which could be very legitimate reasons for not being able to meet those social obligations, so-called. Indeed, it may be impossible for them to do so because they don't have access to those services in the area, because their PHO has a closed book or a long waiting list, because their local ECE provider or kindergarten only accepts children for up to 12 hours a week, so they can't meet the 15-hour-a-week requirement. All of these are perfectly legitimate reasons not to meet these obligations, and the government knows this, and they know that around 2,000 families will find it difficult to meet these obligations and have budgeted and fully expect to sanction around 1,300 parents a year in these situations. Now, that's a huge number of children who will be adversely affected by those sanctions, and there's something very wrong and very cynical about that. Budgeting for savings from sanctioning families, which they know will disadvantage children. Essentially, they're banking the kids' lunch money, Mr. Speaker, and it's very disappointing and it's very disturbing. And again, it completely undermines the apparent objective of improving outcomes for children. It also breaches our obligations under our international human rights obligations, like the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, for children to have the right to benefit from social security. Mr. Speaker, it's an absurd logic that underpins this bill, and it's a logic that will do nothing more than harm children who are already vulnerable and who we all acknowledge we are not doing enough for at the present time. And the Green Party is proud to stand in opposition to this bill and to stand up for our most vulnerable children.
I call Mike Sabin.
Speaker, very pleased to stand in support of this particular social security amendment.